Bill Maluka, and I heartily welcome you to our Theater 100 class. This is the class that looks at the related performance fields of film, television, and theater, with hopes of perhaps turning you on to going to see some theater. We all see a lot of film and television, but we do focus a little bit more in this class on theater. So today is our intro to the intro class, so we will talk about the class and how it's structured. The second half of the class today, I really want to introduce you to some film terms, and we have some examples, little clips that we can look at to help understand part of the artistry of what cinematographers go through. But first, I do want to just inform you about this whole program that we're running here, the Young Scholars Program. This course is part of this Young Scholar Program at Cal State San Hills, and high school students with a B average or better can enroll in two courses and earn up to 6 units of college credit for $3.50. That's a pretty good deal. In fact, it hasn't changed for 15 years here. So you can't get a better deal than that. This semester, we're offering four courses here. Music 101, Introducing Music, and that's on Mondays from 3 to 4:30. Our class, Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater, that's Tuesday, 3 to 4:30. Sociology 101, which is the individual and society, that's Wednesdays, 3 to 4:30. And then Chicana Studies 100, that is the Americas, on Thursdays from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Enrollment is open until Friday, February 11th. For more information and an application, there's the number for the Young Scholar Program, 310-243-2288. It's a wonderful program. I've been doing this broadcast segment for many years now. I won't say how long, but it's always been great to be a part of this unique program. So, yes, we're going to talk a lot today about what we're doing here. This is an online class, which may seem like it's rather distant from you, but here at Distance Learning, we like to make it interactive, especially since it's a theater course, and that is what the best of theater is interactive. So we are live and online. We want to hear from you. There's a phone number that you can call from anywhere in North America to either ask a question or respond to a question I might pose to you for the day. So 1-800-339-1193. You may want to write that down and call in. Or a lot of our students will be logging on to this website here, dhtv.csudh.edu, and you might post a question there or respond to a question I might pose to you. So we'll look at the course requirements in a little while, but right now I'd like to introduce you to the basic content of the course and perhaps talk a little bit about theater and film and television. And then we'll get to all the goodies about the syllabus and what's on our Blackboard website and which edition of the book you need to purchase. So we'll cover that in a little bit. But here's a question that does go to perhaps the central idea of the course. How do you view the difference between watching theater and watching a piece of film or television? So how is the experience of watching theater different from watching film or television? Even if you've not seen a lot of theater, it's a unique way to start this class, giving some thought to how these forms are different. So this is an example of a focus question that I would offer at the beginning of the class. And throughout the whole hour and a half that we're together, I have students who might call in on our toll-free number there, 1-800-339-1193, or they may log on to that internet site and post a response to the question. So feel free to join us and interact with me. If you do post your comment, I will be able to read it online here on the broadcast here so that people will be able to hear what you had to say and I'll be able to respond to it. So it's not exactly the dialogue that we like in theater, but it does give us a somewhat circular communication there that can help make the broadcast interesting. Just so you know a little bit about me too, my background is as a theater director. I basically am on faculty here at Theater Arts in Cal State Dominguez, where I teach. I'm very delighted to be able to teach a wide variety of classes. I'm not kind of locked into one thing, but I can teach acting, directing, playwriting, which is something that I really enjoy teaching here. I mainly teach the world theater classes, the theater history class, and in fact, we'll incorporate a little bit of that into our classes here. But I'm a stage director by trade. My work was to find out how to put on a play, a live performance. I've not done film or television, so I'm really a theater director. But I do like working with all the artists in a piece of theater. This is probably why I'm a director. I began as an actor, but I love working with designers. I enjoy working with the writers, with obviously the actors, people who are doing the publicity. So I enjoy being having my hands in everybody's business, I guess. That's why I like being a director. And throughout all of my 10 years while I was a freelance director in New York City, and I spent about 3 years teaching in schools and regional theater companies across America until finally coming here to Dominguez. I'm almost 12 years now at Dominguez Hills, where I've directed, again, I've been very fortunate to direct a wide variety of types of shows. I've directed classics, Shakespeare's Twelfth Night, Sophocles Antigone, Molière's Misanthrope, but I've also directed a lot of contemporary plays, Biloxi Blues, The Art of Dining, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and especially Dominguez Hills, what I've really relished is the chance to write more multicultural plays that focus on not just ethnic groups. I've done August Wilson's Fences here, I've done Octavius Lee's Man of the Flesh, I've done Henry David Lang's Golden Child, Diana Sohn's Boy, which is an Asian American story, but I've also worked on women's theater. We've had a veritable renaissance of women writers at Dominguez, and I'm proud to be able to take a lot of their work and stage it as well. So it is a diverse audience that we have here in Dominguez. The classrooms are filled with a wide diversity of age, variety as well. So for that reason, I've had to expand my horizons by coming here. So I've taken advantage of being at Dominguez Hills. And if you want to hear a little bit more about me, I have our faculty button in the Blackboard site. You can read a little bit more. I have a website there that you might want to go to, so you can learn a little bit more about me or email me. That's fine too. But yes, our class, Theater 100, is a class. It's kind of a generalist class because we are going to look at what goes into the works of theater, film, and television, and how they are different. That is one of the focus questions we're looking at today. But basically, we look at the elements of production in this class. We want to see what the work of a playwright is. We want to look at what the performer's work is all about, both for the actors and the directors. We want to see what is the artistry that goes into the designer's work. After all, we're talking about scenic designers, costume designers, makeup designers, hair designers, lighting designers, sound designers. There's so much that goes into any work of film, television, theater in terms of what it's going to look like, sound like, and what costumes they're going to wear. So we do look at the work of a technical director, a stage manager, even a light board operator. We want to focus on the elements of production so we get a little sense of what happens backstage, what happens in those 6 weeks before the show opens. That's hopefully what this course is going to give you a little insight into. And, you know, the objective is obviously to help you appreciate the performing arts a little bit more. Once you kind of know what goes into the process, you become a little more appreciative of the product that you see. It's like watching the top ninth of the iceberg when you see the show, because you don't realize the eight ninths of it that go in. Also, please understand that I realize that you don't see a lot of theater. Theater is expensive. It's hard to see a lot of theater today. And we don't have basically a kind of pattern of behavior that takes us to live theater a lot. We love seeing those films. We love watching, you know, television, but we don't have a lot of theater in our background. So just want you to know, I'm aware of that. I'm hoping to change that and get you interested in seeing more theater. But my expectations for you is primarily to try to make observations. In other words, if we're reading a play like we do with Raisin in the Sun, what do you see in that play that is unique, that stands out to you? It doesn't matter that you haven't had acting classes or drama literature classes. If you haven't seen a lot of theater, that doesn't mean that you can't watch a work of film or television and make observations of what you thought was really excellent and why you thought it worked. So, to some extent, don't feel that you're unprepared for this class. It's an introduction. So, we are exploring together these three very unique forms. Okay, the structure of these broadcasts. Oh, I see it here. Let me give you an example. I have a student who's responding to our focus question. Remember at the beginning I asked, how does the experience of watching television or film differ from the experience of watching theater? So this is a good example. Here's a focus question, and we have Dolores responding, and we also have, I guess it's Eben. Watching theater, you get more of a personal connection to the actors. I'm glad you see it that way, because a lot of people say, you know, it's so intimate. You're seeing real people in front of you. It has a kind of immediacy. But your point is that it's a personal connection that you have. And I think that's a very important aspect. You, in the audience, feel a little bit more because that person's a live person in front of you. You empathize with them a little bit more than if they're just a big image on the screen. So the liveness of theater makes it quite unique in the experience that you have. That's great. And here's Laura saying, watching theater is different from watching television or film because in theater, you can see the actors' emotions and relate to them. Thank you, Dolores. Dolores was saying that somehow you feel a little bit more because it's so interpersonal. Even if the actors don't look at you, they shouldn't perhaps in the majority of stage plays. But you almost like feel like you're there with them. You're in their world. So it has that kind of immediacy that allows you to feel a little bit stronger. Here's our Oscar Garcia saying, in movies, you can take your time and have retakes. This is you talking about when you make the movie. But in plays, you only have one chance to make it work. There's a huge difference. Oscar, you're absolutely right. There's a huge difference for the actor who can take 27 takes to get it right. That's a whole different way of working. And if you know, there's 500 people sitting out there. I'm making my entrance right now. Whatever happens is going to happen. Those are two totally different experiences, performance experiences. And actors will tell you it's they're hardly related. They're so different. The idea of being able to film for a camera, perform for a camera, and the idea of performing for a live audience, where you can't just say, oh, that was terrible, let's cut there and do another take. You can't do that in live theater. And that's not saying something negative about live theater. That's, in fact, saying that you have to trust what is going to happen right here. You relish the moment, perhaps a little bit more as an actor than you do in film. So that's a great point that Oscar's making. And Oscar's also asking another question, which I'll get to. Does it matter what book edition we purchase for the class? No, it doesn't matter. You can use any edition, but I'm going to have to go over that a little bit later to make sure that you're reading the same chapters that everybody else is reading on a given week. So, yes, Oscar, good question there. But it's important to look at how we're going to structure these broadcasts as well. First of all, I will begin, as I did now, with some announcements. So, this is a class. Some of you are watching it, perhaps, on cable television, and you're wondering, what is he talking about, my students? Well, there is a class here, and we have assignments that the students have to do. So occasionally at the beginning of the class, I'll talk about what's coming up in terms of what's due for the students. But the beginning of the class, what I like to do is do just about 10 minutes of the history of theater. Why history? It may sound boring, but strangely enough, there's a fabulous background to theater that tells us not just about how the Greeks or the Elizabethans in Shakespeare's time or the neoclassicist in Molière's time did theater, but it tells us how we do theater today. There's an intricate connection between the history of theater and what's still valuable today in how we work. An example is, for instance, an 18th century critic who talked about whether an actor goes on stage and uses real emotion or do they work from their head. This was Denis Diderot in France who was saying that it'd be too messy if actors used their real feelings because it'd be a sloppy performance. He felt that an actor has to use their head to act. Now, a lot of contemporary theorists, acting teachers would say, oh, no, you can't use your head, you have to use your heart, it has to come from your emotions. So that debate is eternal. It goes on and on. So the history of theater, in a way, does tell us a lot about theater itself. It's not just going back and see how it was done before, but it highlights a lot about what we do today. So anyway, that's just a little kind of teaser at the beginning of the program, talk about the history of theater. Then we go into the content of the readings, and as we'll go through this later on, you have an assignment button every week. Students have to hit that and find out what chapters we're reading for the week. So hopefully you've read those chapters before the broadcast so that we can now talk about them. So then we focus on the content of the course. As an example, next week we're reading about the audience. We're reading two chapters, chapter 1 and 2, which tells us about the expectations of the audience, what audiences bring. And quite honestly, in theater, as well as film and television, you kind of have to know who your audience is before you even start writing the play. Who is this for? Before I decide I'm going to do a Shakespearean play, I've got to know who's out there. Is it going to be a second grade? 150 second graders at a local elementary school? So you got to know who is it being performed for. Oftentimes in the broadcast, I will finish with either guest artists. So sometimes I'll bring in, for instance, we'll bring in the director of our first show here, Courtney Muller. So she's going to talk about the show she's doing in the attempt to help you understand the director's process. So sometimes there will be a guest artist. Also, at certain times during the semester, we look at films. There's 5 films that we are going to focus on. And spend a whole day just talking about those films. So, in other words, what I'm saying is sometimes the structure is going to change a little bit as well. But during the entire broadcast, I always take questions and answers from our audience. They're not really here, but we would like to think that they are. In fact, that's a real challenge there, I know, to have the courage to call in. But it's always fun to have someone on the phone, so feel free to use the 1-800-339-1193 number and post a question or respond to our focus question today, for instance, about the differences between film, television, and theater in terms of you watching it. And there's our website, so dhtv.csudh.edu. You can also log on to respond to our question here about how is the experience of watching theater different from watching film or television. Okay, also want to talk a little bit about what makes theater unique, because we've already referred to it in a number of the comments that I've gotten here. One of the things is that immediacy makes live theater so unusual and we're so used to seeing filmed works on our television. You know, we're watching Lost, and even though we can be quite engaged in the story, it still is a film made for television. When we are face to face with actors who are live people in front of us, that immediacy draws us in a very unique way, as it has done for centuries. So there's something about how the technology has made theater even perhaps more necessary now. So I'm hoping that you'll take me up on it. Famous scholar from the 18th century, Samuel Taylor Coleridge, once said that we have a willing suspension of disbelief when we walk into a theater. Now, this is kind of a strange term, but it's almost like I had a student just recently talk about, I want to be fooled. I want to come in and leave my life aside and go to a place where I can believe what's going on, even though I know that this is a play and they've probably done it 27 times before they're doing it tonight, but I want to feel that it's happening right now for the first time. This is reality. Strangely enough, we
do something in our heads that allows us to buy into that. It's almost a little devious what we do there. We put on some kind of a strange illusion. We use our imagination. A lot of times we think we're watching a film or television or a piece of theater in a very passive way. We just want the lights to go out so that we can just sit there and eat our popcorn and watch. But you have to participate. You, no matter what of these three forms we're talking about, you are participating in some unique way, and it's usually your imagination. So that's perhaps one of the feature aspects to these three different forms. And the communion with an actor and an audience, especially in live theater, is very unique. Actors will tell you that they'll come off stage and they'll say, wow, this audience is dead. There's nothing out there. And they'll come off another time and they'll say, wow, you feel how tight they are on everything that we're doing. They can sense how riveted or not an audience might be. So again, it's not passivity that you have when you're sitting out there. You're participating in a very strange way, and probably goes back to the origins of theater, which I will talk about when we get to Look at Ritual next week in our first theater history segment, which is that the original actors were the shamans, the priests, the sacred persons who led the communities in rituals, rituals that were designed to help us, our group, survive. So there's that same connection there that is, actors will call it a sacred communion that they have with the audience. And also, there's entertainment. And I'm not just talking about musicals or comedies. There's a certain amount of entertainment just in being able to see craftsmanship or craftsmanship that goes into, oh, there's a great example right there in terms of the artistry that is there in the costumers and what the designers are doing, the artistry that's there in the human voice. And that's a lovely thing about live theater, and you certainly can get it as well in film and television, to hear, you know, the human voice open up either in a monologue or a song or something like Lion King, where you hear such beautiful expression. And physicality, movement, even if it's not a dance concert you're watching, it could be a straight piece of theater, there's still beautiful movement there. So the skill of execution provides a kind of entertainment that is makes it easy to enjoy. Also, I think another thing that makes theater unique is the collaboration. Interesting that Lion King should be up there, because that was a wonderful collaboration of artists, puppeteers, as well as actors were involved in creating this extraordinary play. Julian Taylor was a superb puppeteer, as well as a great stage director, film director as well, film director of Frida. So there's an interesting community of artists that combine together in a piece of work like this. And if you can appreciate that, it's very, very unique. So, also, for us, as we watch a piece of film, television, or especially theater, we're watching life struggle. To some extent, we are watching ourselves on stage. Many have talked about theater as being a mirror that is placed in front of the audience so that they can see themselves. And that's so true. Even today, when we have so many other options, it's interesting how people still flock to the theater and to film and television to see something about themselves, to learn something more about the lives that they're leading, which sounds contradictory when you're going to see another family on stage. But that is the unique connection here that makes theater, life's double, a chance to see your life in a way on stage. Finally, the focus of a play is human beings. And this is one of the greatest humanistic arts that we have. It's not to go and see a painting, you're not going and seeing a sculpture, you're not going to see something that is technically an object. You're looking at a human being, that's the art object in a piece of theater. So it's unique in that aspect. If you're lucky enough to have seen, Robeson do Othello, for instance, what makes these performers so unique, I think we have an image there of Robeson in the role of Othello, it makes you realize why people really go to the theater. They want to see that grand human expression. We'll talk about Robeson a lot more. He was a fabulous actor in 20th century became actually quite an exponent of social causes too throughout the 40s and 50s. But why people go to the theater to see that kind of skill of execution, to see storytelling there also is something that is almost ritual. The concept of sitting down and listening to someone tell a story, or in this case, perform the story and actually put it on in front of us as if it's happening again. Storyteller is always working in the past tense, whereas a play always happens in the present tense. So it's there's a new immediacy that comes with portraying it, not just telling it. Playwrights will tell you, the idea is to show the play, not tell the play. That's what makes a true piece of theater. And also, we learn about cultures from all over the world. We learn about people living very different lives than we live. Plays are very informative about the world that we live in. And as I've been mentioning too, another thing that makes people go to the theater is because of the spiritual experience that is there. The origins of theater are ritual, but they're still connected to what Aristotle talked about in his famous book, The Poetics, where he said that there's a catharsis that you go through when you watch a piece of theater. You kind of relieve yourself of the tensions of your day by watching another person go through some tragedy. So there's lots of reasons that we go, but it's interesting to think about the spiritual connection that's there. Okay, well anyway, that's just a very brief introduction to some of the content of the class. But before we take a break, and I always do take a break midway, like about a quarter of perhaps, let's look at the actual course. I don't want to bore the people who are just perhaps watching as a broadcast. But for the students, I know you may have a lot of questions, so let's go through some of the requirements for the course. Hopefully you've been able to go onto our Blackboard site. Maybe we can actually give the students an image here of our Blackboard site for Theater 100. I don't know if we can do that from the booth, but our website, there it is. Great, thank you. You'll see here we have a picture from a Samuel Beckett play that is a very, very odd play. It's called Endgame, and it's a rather dark play. And this man, Ham, this is like the end of the world, and his parents have both lost their legs, and he keeps them in trash cans. So it is a very strange image of a world that has no real hope. And that's perhaps Beckett's point about Endgame. He was also the man who wrote Waiting for Godot. So, a little sense of comedy within the tragedy is known as Theater of the Absurd, and we will get to that as well. But this is our site, and here are the buttons that I hope that this week, in our intro week, you get to look at all of these. Here is how to view the class. So, technically, it gives you information that Warren Ashley has provided to help students make sure they're able to see these broadcasts either live or in the archived version. Here's our announcements here, and in fact, if I scroll down, here's the welcome that we have for the class. And I just want to alert you to one other thing. At the bottom here, I have an announcement which I actually sent as an email to the class, how to forward your tutorial mail to home. I send a lot of emails to the class through the Blackboard, but if you're not checking your Toro mail, then you're not getting it. But there is a way of forwarding your mail from Dominguez Hills to your home email. So you should look this over and do that if you were hoping to get feedback from your instructor. And once you write your writing assignments, that is how you get feedback. So it is something you're going to need to check. We don't have to go through all of this, but one of the buttons that you busted is the syllabus. So this is just simply this 4 or 5 page document that tells you everything that you really need to know in the class. For instance, the textbook. Now here's Edwin Wilson's 10th edition of the book. This is a beautiful book. I mean, when a book goes through 10 or 11 editions, it's got to be good. Wilson is a very clear writer. I like the way that he structures a paragraph. Each paragraph says one thing, and then he goes on to the next thing. He's very informative, but it's not dry. very good writer. So this is the 10th edition of the Theater Experience, and I just want you to know that it just came out with the 11th. So some of you may have gone ahead and gotten the 11th edition of the book, which is great. In fact, some of you may still have the 9th edition. I don't mind that you use a variety of editions for the class. I shouldn't say that. The publisher wants me to make sure I sell the 11th. But I want you to get the information, and it hasn't really changed too much. But what has changed? The chapter numbers in this are no longer the same ones as in the 11th. So please notice that when you go to your assignment page, and that's like the 4th button down in the Blackboard site here, I'd say every weekend you should hit that assignment page to find out what's coming up in the week. And one of the first things that you'll read is that this week we are going to read Chapter 7 in The Theater Experience. Now, Chapter 7 in this is on directing. Chapter 8 in this is on directing. So you'll have to do some work. In the assignment page, I actually say, in the 11th edition, this is Chapter 8. So you shouldn't get confused, but just realize that the syllabus is built on the 10th edition. If you have the 10th, you have no problem. If you have the 11th or any other ones, disregard the number of the chapters and make sure you're following the right topic. So if the topic happens to be the director, you're okay. So don't worry about the numbers. I won't make any sense there. Just don't want you to get lost between editions. But I also don't want to limit you to just one edition. Also, as you read on our syllabus, the only other thing that we're going to read is this one play, Raisin in the Sun. Again, this play you can get in many different editions. It's been published in endless editions since 1959. Just be sure that you get the stage play and not the film script. All right, so we are reading Lorraine Hansberry's original play that she wrote for the stage, not the version that was done for the film. Oscar's got lots of questions here. Oscar, this is great. Thanks for asking this question. What happens if you miss a class session? Well, we send you through the spank line, Oscar. No, actually, if you miss one of our broadcasts, our distance learning people are placing this in, I should say, archive, because it actually, I believe, goes up to YouTube. Now we have a slot in YouTube, so you can get the archived version of the broadcast. You won't be able to interact with me as you're doing now, Oscar, but you shouldn't have to miss one of the segments because you can catch it later on at any time watching it on the archived version that's up on YouTube. Correct me in the booth if I'm wrong about that. Anyway, the syllabus, really, you need to look through it in great detail. I have objectives here. I have how your work is assessed. There are statements about academic integrity. We do have in your writing assignments a pretty serious focus on plagiarism, so we'll talk about that in a little bit. I have a policy here on late work, which you should be aware of. This is not a face-to-face class, so to some extent, online versions require the student to be much more responsible than in a face-to-face class where the teacher might say to you on Thursday, oh, next Tuesday, now you know your writing assignment is due. Well, I will give you as much as I can in the broadcast about that, but it's really up to you to know what's coming up, and that's why I have the assignment page, assignment button there on Blackboard, very clearly outlining what you're going to need to do. So the work is due on the dates indicated in the assignment pages. Make sure you're aware of that, that if we're going to read this book, this chapter, for today's broadcast, that's when it's due, not later on in the week. And I actually have quizzes as well as discussion boards, and I'll talk about them now, which are due either on Tuesday or Thursday. So truly, college level success depends on your ability to schedule responsibly, and sadly, some students only learn that after being penalized for poor time management. So use your initiative and your sense of organization to look ahead to what is due in the class, and that's true of all classes, right? Let's look at some of these requirements very briefly. Students are required to submit their work correctly on time. Online education is student-centered, but let's talk about participation, how you participate in this class. In order to maintain your active participation in the class, you're expected to view the live or archived TV web broadcast each week. you receive extra credit by regularly sending responses to the folks' questions on the broadcast. So, Oscar, that's good news for you, right? You're expected to log on to the Blackboard site at least twice a week to find out what's going on. But most importantly, students receive participation points for contributing to the discussion board, which is on Blackboard, each week. Now, there's 13 weeks of broadcast, but the discussion board starts next week, technically, in terms of creating a discussion board. I have a discussion board this week just to introduce yourself to the class. So feel free to use that, and we'll talk about the profile in a little bit as well. But the 12 graded discussion boards starting next week all the way through to week 13 are basically a posting that takes place in two parts. You get 10 points for posting a question or an observation, and then 10 points for responding to another student's posting. So it is not exactly discussion, but it is responding back and forth to each other's posts. And both of those posts are due by Thursday of each week. So by midnight of Thursday, that's when the discussion board is due. So there's 20 points for each discussion board posting, okay? And that's based on the chapter reading. So if we've read the chapter on acting, for instance, and you have an observation about whether actors are really using their real feelings, you may post that there, and then another student will respond. You'll see on the, I have the directions pretty clearly. Maybe we should show this just so that students are aware of what the discussion board looks like. When you click on this button, all the way down here toward the bottom, it says discussion board. You'll be taken into this area here, and I know you can't read this, but just so that this is our kind of free discussion board this week, a non-graded, non-required opening activity just to get accustomed to the discussion board. But next week, you'll see week number 2, the audience chapters 1 and 2, due February 11th. So it's very specifically stated when this is due, and here are here's a very detailed description of technically how you add a thread and how you then reply to another student's thread. So if you read this, you'll do fine. If you go in and just try to do it on your own and have never done it before, you may be a little lost. But this talks about the purpose of the discussion board, that it gives you a chance to reflect on your own readings, and it's meant to help you synthesize what you are reading in the textbook. Okay, so that's the discussion board, and I think when you read through the syllabus, it'll make a lot more sense. Also, another part of the participation grade are the 30 points that you can get by doing a profile, so that other students can read about you. In fact, I asked you to post a picture that you have. Cynthia posted a picture of Big Sur just this morning, which was great to see that beautiful landscape there. So tell us a little bit about yourself, maybe what your expectations are for taking this class, maybe one experience you may have had in seeing any theater, maybe a show that you've seen. So it's meant to be an introduction to the class about yourself. So that's the profile, and you'll see that on Blackboard. We have a special little button there where it says Create Homepage on the left-hand side. So it is designed to be very easy for you to don't worry about that. And here's B. Martinez asking, what if we can't access Blackboard yet? Well, then you have a problem that I can't help you with. If you're enrolled, you should be able to get onto Blackboard. I don't know how long after you actually enroll. I thought that it was pretty immediate. So that shouldn't be a problem. And you can always contact one of our technical people here too. Like Warren Ashley, I mentioned that. So, and there may be some problems I'm reading about right here where A&R is having problems. So there may be some technical problems. You need to call the distance learning program here. Oscar's asking, are we allowed to go ahead in chapters, or do we have to just stick to the default? Obviously, Oscar, you can you can go ahead and do as much as you want in this class ahead of time. How am I going to know, right? And I would say that's a good idea to read ahead so that you're familiar with the material that's coming up. So that when you do your discussion boards, when you do your writing assignments, you're kind of free to do those creatively. So absolutely, you can work ahead of how you work ahead of us, but behind us. Yes, so good question, Oscar. Writing assignments. There are free writing assignments for this class, and unfortunately, I have another section here where if you go to the course material page, that's on the Blackboard on the left-hand side, click on the course material page, and in there, I have the writing guidelines. So that's a long document that is meant to help you understand what exactly we are looking for when you write. For instance, we have a character analysis that you write for Raisin in the Sun. You choose one character from the play, and you do an analysis, literally, using examples from the play to prove what you think that character is all about. We also do a review of a film. You go and see a feature-length film and write a review about it. And in these guidelines I'm mentioning that are on the Blackboard page, I have questions that help you to analyze the film. Not that you have to answer every one of those questions. They're just suggestions to help you think about the film. Okay? But again, that piece of writing is another experience of critical thinking where if you come out of a film and you say, I really thought that was terrible, well, critical thinking is what tells us why. So you may want to point out that the acting seemed very slow, the pace of the way the actors were saying their lines was very slow. Now, make observations, and it doesn't mean you have to have had a lot of experience to know this. Just think about it a little bit more. What bothered you about the film? Maybe somehow the editing was just so quick and so sharp that you couldn't get a sense of what was going on. So make observations. That's what this writing exercise is about. And in fact, the final one is where I ask you to go and watch a stage play. Literally go see a piece of live theater. It doesn't have to be the Martin Forum. It doesn't have to be, you know, something professional. It can be a high school performance, community college. It can be a local community theater. So there's a lot of theater around us that you probably don't know about. And that's perhaps what I'm doing too, is helping you get in touch with the theater that is there in your community. So go see that. And again, on the writing guidelines, I have a whole list of questions that can help you analyze what the playwright's work was, what the actor's work was, what the director did in that. Only these questions, again, are only to help you think about it, so that then you can compose a review where you basically say, I think this was a wonderful piece of work, and here's why. Here's an example. When this actor came out to confront her mother, there was a very serious, sad kind of scene that went on, and you describe the acting in that moment. So, give examples, is all I'm saying. So that's the essence of the three writing assignments for the class: the character analysis, the review of a film, and the review of stage play. It has to do with how well you take out the microscope and analyze it. That's the heart of it. Also, the textbook, every week, we have a quiz. And the quiz is in the assignment section of Blackboard. You can't get it any other way. So you'll see under that assignment section for that specific week, you click the link and it takes you to these questions. Now, it's a timed quiz. It's obviously open book, but I wouldn't waste time looking around. As long as you've read the specific chapter that we are focusing on, you should be okay. So there's usually about 10 questions, all multiple choice or true and false. So that's a way to help you, you know, kind of retain what you're reading about in the chapters. So those quizzes, there are 9 of them. They start next week, and each one of those is 20 points. So all the syllabus, again, you should really get this in print for yourself, so you have a whole great distribution of exactly what these grades all add up to. There is a midterm, there is a final exam as well. So it's good for you to kind of inform yourself about what is being required. Okay, I think I mentioned about academic integrity and participation, the writing assignments, the quizzes, the midterms, and final exams, and if you really sad fact about the grade distribution is that almost most of the course is based on your writing and your participation in the discussion board. That adds up alone to more than 50%. So I guess even though the focus is going to be on me in the broadcast throughout the week, it's what you do with the material that you're reading, both in the textbook and the PAs, in what you're writing, your writing assignments, your discussion board postings. So that's pretty much what the course is designed to do, is to get you to respond to what you're reading. The weekly schedule, that is important also in the syllabus to ensure that you have an idea of what's coming up. Otherwise, when you fall behind, it's real tough for you to catch up. I mean, that's the goal of almost every course that you take. But this weekly schedule that you find in the syllabus is the same that you're going to find in the assignment page. I would say make sure you're hitting that assignment page each weekend, or maybe even ahead of time so you know what's coming up. But the weekly schedule in the syllabus gives you the whole view of the semester so you can plan accordingly for yourself. What do you need to get an A in my class? Quite honestly, you just need to read. It's all there, online, in the syllabus, in the writing guidelines. If you take on a writing assignment and haven't really done the homework to see what I'm asking for, you may be a little surprised by the grade you get. I am only providing the guidelines to help you do well in the course, so please do read them. The chapters in the book are, I think, quite wonderful. And I think the way that the website is organized, you should find that it's pretty simple to navigate your way around. It just means, which is what this week is for, is you spend some time getting to know it so that you don't have to be learning it in the fifth week, it's sixth week. So find out now what's there. Make sure you click on everything so that you'll know where to go when you have a question. All right. Well, I said we were going to take a break, so I think that's a good idea. Which, for those of you who maybe are new to Dominguez Hills, the tape we're going to run right now gives you a little insight into what we do here. It's a very unique place, I can guarantee you that. And while we come back, let's look at film, some of the basics of the way films are shot, which helps us appreciate the artistry behind it. So look forward after the break to talking with you more about intro to film, television, and theater.
Hey, what's up? I'm Nicole Aaron.
And I'm Shayna, and you guys are watching University TV.
Today we're at California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Home of the tour of the
Science Center Campus Tour.
Cal State Dominguez Hills is located in Carson, California, in the greater Los Angeles region. Just minutes from the beach, downtown LA, and Southern California's entertainment centers and attractions.
The park works in on the Cal State Dominguez Hills campus sits on 346 acres, providing plenty of places to study or lounge outside and enjoy the California weather. And all buildings are only a short walking distance from one another. You'll also find pedestrian paths lined by eucalyptus or other shade trees.
Known as the color on the hill, the campus makes good use of the tree. With many buildings built at varying elevations, the campus street level is the second story of most buildings, and bridge walkways provide a seamless connection.
Dominguez Hills is first to be able to explore the surface of the system. It's an amazing place to be, it's a beautiful campus, and very, very popular.
The university enrolls about 12,000 students per semester and is one of the most ethnically and culturally rich student bodies in the U.S. No one ethnic group on campus is in the majority. The student body is 70% female to 30% male.
Well, as an educator, I have my option to assist in the school. And as I think I'm here, I'm going to be a teacher and have a teaching program, so I'm teaching a teacher. I'm going to be a teacher and have a teacher. And that's one of the big things that we get
concerns with healthy savings issues. Most of our students have a specific GPA requirement that corresponds with the SAT or ACT score. The higher your GPA, the less weight you put on the score. The lower GPA, the stronger that weight needs to be.
Students with GPAs below 2.0 are not eligible for admission.
For California residents, the average full-time fee for the university is $3,400, not including the cost of books or housing. Battlestate students pay about $400 extra per unit. The university offers many financial aid options, including scholarships and grants.
Battlestate's biggest help gives you more choice of 45 bachelor's, 21 master's degrees, and 10 teaching credential certificate programs. Some of the students' favorite majors include liberal studies, business administration, digital media arts, child development, and nursing.
Want to work in television or the motion picture or music industries? Cal State Davis hosts digital media arts programs successfully prepare students for careers in those fields.
The legend holds true. There's a ghost in every theater. The Dominguez Hill spirit comes to every play, opens the elevator doors, and wishes the cast good luck.
The university also has the largest master's degree program in conflict resolution and peacebuilding. PC Orthotics and Prosthetics program is one of only 7 such programs in the nation.
For 687 faculty members, the university has a student faculty ratio of 23:1.
The university has 11 men's and women's girls athletic teams, which compete at the NCAA Division II level.
The girls won 23 conference titles and 3 national championships. Plus, the Cal State students, unlike most college residents, halls or dormitories. Their comp consists of 22 two-story buildings with 1, 2, and 3 bedroom furnished apartments, all with full kitchens. The apartments were originally built to house athletes for the 1984 Summer Olympics.
I do currently live in Campus Albion. It's a nice experience. I'll have mom here to tell me what to do. But also, it gives me the opportunity to interact with people on a more intimate setting. Students can select from 60 student-run groups to join or participate in, from cultural and special interest organizations to professional service and honor society groups. There are also 5 fraternities and 8 sororities on campus.
There's a lot of issues we get involved in. It wants to be involved in clubs and organizations, sports, or something. But we love a big strategy when we want to be all
Addicted to reality TV? Well, here's your reason to get off the couch. The Associate Students Department of Food Activities together for the things every year. Today, the amazing race.
Dan Grissett, a pianist composer who has worked with people like Herbie Hancock and Prince, Daisy Nash, actors whose television credits include Reno 911 and Clean House, and John Lang, he's the co-creator and executive producer of classically entertaining Cops.
Older first, or I think cast musicals would be because it is an old movie.
If you're looking for a friendly student folks university where you won't get lost in the seats and everyone knows your name, be sure to check out Cal State Dominguez Hills in the heart of beautiful Southern California.
Thanks for joining us here in Carson, California,
on our campus tour of California State University.
Well, we're back, and I hope that explained a little bit of what a unique environment we have here. E.C. Nash, for instance, one of our alumni in theater arts. We have Clarence Gilliard, who was had quite a successful television career back in the 80s and 90s, and still going strong. He's actually directing our production of Three Sisters. I will bring in some information about the shows that we're doing, so hopefully if you're near to our campus, you might want to come and see one of our shows. So anyway, thank you for returning to Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater. I'm Bill DeLuca, and this is our first broadcast for the spring 2010 semester. We talked a little bit in the beginning about the course, how it's structured, and the things that make theater, film, television interesting. Some of you are thinking about calling in right now, 1-800-339-1193. We focused a question your way about the
the differences between watching film and television and the difference with watching theater. How is that different? Already some students have talked about the immediacy that comes from a live situation. But if you have any other ideas that you want to share with us, feel free to use that phone number and call, or log on as Oscar and many of the other students have done already at dhtv.csudh.edu. Good. So what I'd like to do now is talk a little bit about film and show you some examples. It's interesting to be able to have a little sense of the different types of shots that are used in film, because once you kind of understand that, then you can see how one is put together. There is something of an artistry that goes into it. So, and we are going to spend five of our days on the broadcast looking at specific films from the last 20-some years. But it's good to kind of get an idea of what is the artistry behind film techniques. So these are just clips that we're going to share with you just to talk about what goes into it. And obviously what makes film unique is, and we've talked a little bit about this already, is the sense that it is a medium that has such power in terms of taking us to a specific location. And that is the basic thing about film, is you take that camera wherever you want to go. So now instead of building a set to show some wonderful deserted isle, you can go to some deserted isle and film it right there. So the immediacy that comes from bringing the camera to the location is extraordinary. But not only do you have that camera telling a story, but the use of a variety of different shots is wonderful as well. So let's take a look at some of these. And obviously the first factor that you have to consider is the distance between the subject and the camera itself. So we have three basic types of shots called the establishing shot, which is obviously when there's a lot of distance between the camera and the subject. And what does the shot establish? Obviously it establishes where we are. So an establishing shot could be the outside of a restaurant, let's say. So we know the general idea of where we are. Whereas a medium shot now brings us a little closer. And perhaps we are seeing a couple sitting at a table, so we get more information that is more specific than just the general restaurant. So this medium shot may be just the top of the table, so that we're seeing torso and then looking at each other, right? So a medium shot is good for showing the alignment between people, whether or not people are open to each other, or maybe they're closed away from each other. So there's a lot of specific information that you get in the medium shot that you might not get in the establishing shot. And then finally, a close-up is the real artistry of film. What would film be without a chance to really come in close? Because now you are getting a clear reaction from that actor. And it may be something very subtle that they do with an eyebrow, but just as the long shot establishes the location, we now have a medium shot that brings the characters into their environment, but a close-up is where the camera can really draw onto the face and give us the sense of what dynamics are really going on inside that actor, inside that character. So, even as early as Charlie Chaplin was brilliant, even though he used so many establishing shots to show 30 policemen running after him down the street, then all of a sudden you get a close-up of him feeling relieved that they just passed him by. So the close-up is essential to film. It really tells us what's going on inside the person, whereas the establishing shot and the medium shot are more telling about the larger circumstances. I also wanted you to note, as we watched those little graphics go by, where we said establishing shot, medium shot, close-up, these are the graphics that you should be looking for to write down so you'll know what's going to be on the exam. Many of you may have thought in the class, well, what are the exams going to be on? I do not post an outline that says, here's the exam items. So what do I read for when I read
in the theater experience, or what do I look for when you're talking about film? Watch the broadcast, and when you see these graphics come up, then you're going to know what's going to be on the exam. Now, that's relating to film and what is in our textbook. Okay, so I wouldn't do that, for instance, if I'm talking about theater history, and I refer to a character from theater history, but when it has to do with our textbook, in fact, that's where the tests really come from. But also, film techniques is important. So look for the graphics during the broadcast and write them down, and you'll have your own outline for the exams. Okay. So let's look at a video clip here that shows the movement from establishing shot to medium shot to close-up. This is from the film Chocolat. I don't know if any of you saw it. It's a beautiful film. Juliette Binoche, quite beautiful, was in it. Johnny Depp is in it, Judi Dench. And notice how the first shot you're going to see a kind of distant view of this table where they're going to have a dinner. And then you actually see people carrying the food out from the kitchen out to the table. And then you actually see a medium shot where now we're going to see people sitting next to each other. And then eventually you're going to get close up. That pattern from establishing the medium to close up is just natural to film. And we'll see it, you know, in many different versions. So here's a little clip from Chocolat. So when Judi Dench says that he wasn't invited, we wanted to see what Juliette Binoche thought of that, so we got a close-up on her. So the importance of close-ups and the contrast with establishing shots and medium shots, that gives a film such an interest. I mean, realize that the question of focus is so important. This is another example of a close-up. This is a clip from Lion and Sam. Now, this is a film, if you haven't seen it, that is very much based on this wonderfully intimate connection between a father who is mentally challenged, played by Sean Penn quite beautifully, and his daughter, Dakota Fanning, who is marvelous, who loves him, and the whole question of whether he's going to be able to keep, you know, responsibility for taking care of her is the essence of the film. But look at, even in this tiny little interaction, how close-ups work to give you that intimate portrayal of their relationship. So this is from I Am Sam.
I'm stupid.
You are not stupid.
Yes, I am.
No, you are not stupid. So you can read that word.
I hope I can if you can.
Oh, because it makes me happy. It makes me happy hearing you read. Yeah. It makes me happy when you're reading.
He perched in silence for a long time. How can we be so different and feel so much alike this way?
Wonderful film. She's actually preventing herself from reading because she doesn't want to read at a higher level than her own father, who can't read beyond a sixth grade level. So it's quite a compelling story. Hey, Oscar is back with another comment. I Am Sam was a great movie, very touching, and some of us can relate to it. And it's just done beautifully, filmically, in terms of the angles there. But without a close up, how would you present such compelling material? Also realize too that this is a question of focus. So focus is very important in film. And what better way to really bring us in with the telephoto lens? The telephotos are used for a variety of techniques. Obviously, in the landscape, they work really well. But this is an
other clinical claims do, but notice what happens by the mere fact that you're using a telephoto lens to this image of Sean Penn walking down the street. You decide, well, what kind of feeling do you get from the fact that this is so foreshortened? And by that, what I mean is you're going to see the house in the distance looks enormous because of the foreshortening of the lens. Okay, this is from Hunting Sam 2. I mean, you even have in the clip from Beatles song, feeling 2 foot small. The idea that he is lost in this suburban world where how is he going to find Dakota Fanning anymore? He seems lost. But the foreshortening that's caused by that telephoto lens makes the building seem so enormous behind him that he looks so much smaller. If you shot that with a different lens, he wouldn't have that feeling that he was such a tiny little speck. Okay. Also, if you use a wide-angle lens, that does, in a way, the opposite. It brings the environment together. It's great for doing all the great westerns. You know, you could show the whole expanse of a landscape. So a John Ford western was ideal for a wide-angle. Here's a little clip from a film called That Thing You Do, which just... notice how it shows where he works, and it opens up the whole window of this electronics firm where the central character works. Okay, so this is from That Thing You Do. I said it was going to be a short clip tonight, but it was ideal to use the wide-angle lens for that, to show that here he is, lost in this job that's really not going to take him anywhere. He's lost in all the tiny little gadgets that he's selling in this electronics store, and as it turns out, he finally, his band gets a hit, and they get a start, and is able to move on from just being a tiny little salesman. So, to some extent, the wide-angle lens was perfect to show his being kind of lost. Now, another factor is the angle of the camera. What happens when the camera is at a low point shooting up or at a high point shooting down? So let's first look at the low angle shot. Again, there's that graphic. You may want to write that down because you might see that one again. So collect your graphics. But when the camera shoots from below the actor, it makes the actor seem huge. It shows more significance. Now, here's a tiny little clip again from Chocolat. Look at the POV, the point of view that this poor little girl has on, I think it's Albert Molina who walks in. So this is from Chocolat.
I look. What's yours?
I don't know.
Are we in line? The car door, did you stop?
I mean, it's a charming introduction here, and it turns out that he becomes something of a very serious character in the film. But her view from down below, where she's cleaning the floor, or playing the floor, to see him way up there, I mean, this is used quite a lot in films to make the size of the viewed object enormous. It doesn't have to be just an actor. It can be used for a number of things. So a low angle shot makes the object seem very significant. Whereas if we look at the reverse, when you're shooting from above down, it's going to make everything seem insignificant. So the high angle shot is a great way to kind of minimize what's going on below. Here's a very short clip in from Purple Rose of Cairo that makes all the guests tiny little insects. Okay, this is from Purple Rose of Cairo, Woody Allen. And so many filmmakers have used it so badly. Hitchcock has that fabulous shot from Psycho where you see him carrying his mother down to the basement, okay? Hitchcock had filmed that close-up, the whole story would have been given away. But because he films from way up on top of the ceiling down, you don't get all the information that you should be perhaps getting. So Hitchcock was very devious in using that high angle shot in Psycho. So it can be used for a number of purposes, but it really does make everything seem smaller. And here's Oscar saying the low angle shot is meant to make a person superior, and a high angle, it makes them seem smaller in photography. That's great, Oscar. That this is drawn directly from photography. So cinematographer's work is based in a lot of these ideas. Very good, thank you. Another thing, though, that makes a film very unique is that it conveys overwhelming sense of reality, which is obviously inherited from the theater. But one of the most important things that film can do that theater cannot do is make the camera move, okay? Which is the nature of movies, right? When you think about that word. So camera movement is very essential. For the camera to be able to move is a huge difference in theater. It allows you, the audience member, to become a participant. That's what happens when the movie camera actually moves. It's almost like you are running alongside Rocky down the street in South Philadelphia. So let's look at how the camera can move to incorporate a human view here. This is just a little example here of pan and tilt. When we talk about panning, we're talking about a camera that is turning left and right, laterally, okay? Whereas tilting is when we are looking like from a low angle to a high angle. So a tilt is vertical. So let's look at an example from this. Here's a scene from Casablanca, which shows us an example of a pan. See, that pan was brilliant because it allowed you to go all the way over to the piano player and focus on him. It almost drew us right to that moment there that he was recognizing that something was wrong here. So it's very, very, very tied into the storyline. So a lot of these angles and movements of the camera are used to help tell the story. Realize it's not just to create a beautiful picture. It's used to bring us into the situation and help us understand what's going on. This is an example of a tilt, a very short example of how a tilt can create a little impact truly madly deeply. So the section, you know, from the guitar going up to the actor raised our interest and gave us that low angle shot, but it's basically a tilt. So the camera's sitting on a tripod, and the cameraman is basically tilting it up. So those two terms we'll see quite a lot. In fact, the origins of pan were in the early days of film when they would put a camera on the back of a train, and they would create a view of the panorama. All right, so a certain extent, it comes from that whole landscape idea. I think tilt is pretty common origins there. But the other most important thing, and this is very important to Westerns especially, is the dolly or tracking shot. Now, this is where you're not just on a tripod panning it this way. You've got your tripod and your camera on some kind of wagon that is moving. I mean, it could be a car, it could be a variety of different forms of moving. But this is really what you need to follow Rocky as he's running down the streets. But this is, in fact, the shot we have here from Amelie, which is a beautiful, beautiful film, actually. But notice the very sophisticated use of tracking here. Try to imagine, for instance, yourself being behind the camera. And notice the movement that you have to take to come to finally figure out what's going to happen to the suitcase. It's basically the story of a suitcase that gets lost and found by, you'll see, Amelie ends up picking it up. But it's a great example of dolly work for a camera. So this is from Amelie. Shot was so imaginative. I mean, you notice how the dolly comes into the suitcase, but then it swings around, so it's actually a turn on the wagon, on the dolly, to focus on the suitcase, and then here comes Audrey Tautou to go and pick it up, and then it tilts up to see her holding the suitcase, which obviously is a central prop in the whole film. So, again, that was, it happened so fluidly, you don't tend to realize it when you're watching the film for the first time. But that's not being aware of the different shots. Perhaps makes you appreciate a lot more what they do. It should end up looking simple, but there's a lot of thought that goes into how to plan that to work out so well. Here's another example. A lot of the cinematography in Amelie was quite lovely, but once you have a crane that you can put the camera on and go up into the air, to not just shoot down for that high angle shot, but to actually move it towards your subject, then you get a whole different sensation of the movement of the camera. So, crane shots, very, very famous shot from Gone with the Wind, when Scarlett was walking amid this huge field of injured and dead soldiers, and crane just seemed to keep going up and up and up as more and more injured soldiers were appeared. I mean, it was a beautiful use of a crane shot. But this is another one for a little different sense of purposes. You'll see. But try to again imagine yourself behind the camera, taking the journey that you would have to take to capture this shot. So this again is from Amelie. Now that was an edit there, but the crane did bring you above looking down for a high angle shot, and then it was an edit that got you closer to the pages. By edit, I mean a shot is basically one uninterrupted running of the camera, right? So we should clarify that at the beginning. As soon as you stop the camera, now you're going to put that clip together with another clip, and that's an edit. You're putting two together. So once you edit these shots together, you'll have a scene, right? And then once you can put a series of scenes together into a whole sequence, right? And the sequences add up to a whole film. So there's a way of building a film, too, in terms of the structure. As Eric is responding to Amelie, saying, this was the first French film that really got me interested in French film. So bravo, Eric, because it's a great film. It's worth seeing a couple times. But thank you for sharing that with us, too. It's, for any of you who haven't seen it, definitely find out somebody who's got Netflix and treat yourself to Amelie this weekend. Okay, fade outs and fade in. Now, this is theater terminology. The idea of the lights going down on the stage, maybe a scenic piece gets brought in and they fade back up again. In film, we'll have fade outs and fade in so that we get a full dissolve. But here's an example, for instance, from Ethan Frome, an early film that is. A beautiful classic, but it's beautifully realized by this John Madden, who actually directed it, the same man who did Shakespeare in Love, beautiful film there. But anyway, this is an example of how passage of time can be shown by just using a fade out. Okay, so this is from Ethan Frome.
So you can see you went from a map to a train, but if that had been done as a straight edit, you wouldn't have had the wonderful sensation by making it a fade out of the map and a fade in of the train that he was taking the train to that place on the map that he was looking at. So the combination of that is magical. You don't see that to yourself when you're watching the film, but that's where you go. That's where it takes you. So it's another example of the kind of artistry that goes into the arranging these different shots. The work of the editor is quite exciting, though. It's a huge job in a film. Well, another way that you can go from one shot to another in edit is a wipe. Now, this is a classic. The early years of film used wipes constantly. Notice this shot from the Rocky Horror Picture Show, that you'll see one scene actually kind of move to the side while another scene comes in. It's technically called a wipe. So this is from Rocky Horror Picture Show. You know, I realize film has such a great advantage. You don't have to watch them walking all the way to that front gate. You can just go there in an instant, and a wipe covers the passage of time for you. And the way it was done from that angle of the car to the gate makes it happen easily. The wipe actually is not used as much anymore. For a show that has a sense of comedy like Rocky Horror Picture Show, the wipe was perfect. So sometimes it depends what kind of play or kind of film we're looking at that determines what the editor or the cinematographer is going to choose. I have an interesting question here, David. I'll have to think about this. What is your favorite angle shot in what movie? It's kind of hard to say, but that shot from Citizen Kane at the end, when there's this high angle shot of the, I don't know if you guys know the film, but this man who amasses a fortune in his life. In the end, all he was really looking for was the joys of his childhood, and it was perfectly revealed in this sled that he had when he was a kid. And there's this high angle shot that's looking over all his great acquisitions, and it finally focuses down into the furnace where you see his sled is being burned up. So it's a very sad moment at the end, but I think that is his star. Thank you, David, but there's a lot. It's hard to decide what a favorite, but like so many. Let's see, what else do we have? Slow motion, very important aspect to the film. Slow motion really helps engage the viewer into and we're never upset when they go into slow motion. You see people running through tracks in slow motion, but yet we don't find it weird if people did that in theater all of a sudden broken slow motion. Odd, but in film we can accept this. So here's an example. This is also from Ethan Frome, the same story we were just looking at with the map, but this is a good example of slow motion. So affected by watching that, I hadn't realized that Liam Neeson on the sled and Patricia Arquette was behind him. It's a beautiful story, and what happens is he becomes disabled from this accident for the rest of his life, which is where the story begins. But just considering what happened to his wife, Patricia Richardson, is a sad reflection there. So she was, she died from an accident, not a sled, but it was a sledding accident. So very, very odd to see that again. But when the action is slowed down, you perhaps get a little bit of a sense of the effort that's going into it, especially if it's some kind of like athletic moment. Or obviously for an accident to slow that action down and to draw our focus in, it makes it so much more compelling. It's quite amazing. Okay, one more shot and then we're going to have to wrap it up. But sometimes you can combine shots together. This is a beautiful shot from Amelie. Watch what happens here, because you're going to see a tilt followed by a wipe, and then it's going to pan as we watch Amelie leave the house. And then finally, we're going to get a cut that shows an establishing shot of a restaurant with a wonderful use of the zoom. So now, watch what the camera does, see if you can follow it if you're the cameraman. Watch the movement of the camera and how it engages you in the action. This is from Amelie. Take that whole sequence to show the passage of the seasons and pan over to her now leaving the house and then finally having this job and zooming in on this beautiful tattoo. It's an extraordinary piece of work. I got a great question here from Cassie Weber, who says, how come slow motion is acceptable in film but just seems odd in theater? And quite honestly, Cassie, I don't know if I'm saying your name correctly, that's the difference between theater and film. With theater happening live, it looks odd for somebody to go into slow motion. It doesn't seem real to go into slow motion. Film, we're distant enough away that we can accept it. So, yeah, very, very odd. Okay, if you came in late today, please watch the archived version on YouTube so that you don't miss a lot of the explanation of what we went through in terms of what the class is about. So go to that assignment page and look up what we're going to do for next Tuesday, and have a great week. Thank you for joining us for Intro to Theater, Film, and Film.